Just wanted to give you guys a quick reminder, if you guys love my videos and want to support me, check out compassion-teas.com. Link is at the end of the video. All right, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and this is my last episode coming at you from beautiful Puerto Rico. The sun's out. I see a few clouds in the sky. It's like in the 80s, but I'm headed back on a plane just in a few hours to the mainland, and I've had a great literally week here in Puerto Rico. And the Ann Wigmore Insitute is a place that I have been to before and is a place I'd recommend for you guys to come if you guys need to heal, detox, lose weight, and just eat real clean. And in addition, you guys can learn how to grow your own sprouts, wheatgrass, you know, sunflower greens. You'll learn composting. And also, they're now teaching worm composting here at the Ann Wigmore Insitute in Aguada, Puerto Rico. Yeah, I flew into Aguadilla, cheap flight, $140 is what it's costing me to get back here, all the way back to Vegas, including one carry-on bag. You have to pay extra for the bags on Spirit Airlines. But this episode actually is about worm bins. You know, I espouse the benefits of worms and the worm castings. They're so valuable to your garden. So today we're going to talk about worms and actually the specific two bins that they use here, and then also some of my opinions on keeping worms in your environment so they can benefit you as well as your garden. All right, so now I want to share with you guys more information about worms, keeping worms, and all this good stuff, right? So while I will be showing you guys some flow-through worm bins, which in my opinion, if you are going to keep worms outside their natural environment, the flow-through bin is the one you guys should use, in my opinion. I mean, you could keep worms in like one of those $5 totes from Walmart. You put a couple holes in one and then you interlock it in the other one so you don't get the leachate like in the worms and they're not like sitting in the all the liquid there because they don't like it too moist. You guys could do that, but I'd recommend you guys do the most natural and also the most easiest for you so that you can benefit from the worms, right? I travel so much I cannot keep a worm bin active and going because I'm just not there to take care of it as much as I'd like to or to oversee and make sure they are being kept happy. Because keeping worms, in my opinion, is like having a pet dog or cat. You wouldn't neglect your dog or cat. You wouldn't like leave it without food if you're traveling. You know, you'd give it to your neighbor. I don't know if you could roll your worm bin over to your neighbor's house to have them watch your worms. But, you know, they are living creatures on the planet. And I would encourage you guys to have reverence for all living, you know, creatures, sentient beings on the planet, whether they're worms, chickens, cows, animals, pigs, or whatever. All right. So that being said, let's move on, right? Where's the natural place that worms live? Well, they live in the ground. They live in dirt, they live in the soil, and this is where they would naturally live, and this is where, in my opinion, they should live and where you should be keeping them in your garden. And one of the short videos I made, which is that, you know, how to tell if your garden is healthy or not, is basically just pick up a piece of a good clod of soil, get a good handful of soil. And in that handful of soil, if you have lots of worms in there, like some of my garden beds do, then you know you got a healthy system, you know, because you're able to keep the worms alive in there. That means there's good moisture, there's good food for them, there's good organic matter, they're decaying. And more importantly, they're creating casting for their worm poop, which is even more nutritious than the food that is going into the worms as when it comes out, because it is rich in different enzymes and digesters and nutrients and bacteria and all these things. They're gonna help your plants thrive. Furthermore, it may contain things like chitinase that can help your plants fend off, you know, insects. Anyways, this is the raised bed, one of the raised beds here at the Ann Wigmore Institute. They're actually growing the collard greens or the Swiss chard in here. They have collard greens in the next bed and lettuce and stuff. This place looks pretty good. Maybe it could be planted a little bit more densely, I think. But yeah, check the links down below to videos I've made here in the past about their garden as well as growing sprouts and microgreens. But yeah, so, you know, the thing is, if you don't have worms in your garden now, it's all right. You could buy worms and then transplant them in your garden. It's like rehoming an animal that you could adopt from a shelter instead of going to the pet store, right? Maybe it doesn't have the best life in the pet store and then you get it, or hopefully it's actually from the shelter. And then, you know, you give them a good life. So you could buy worms online, find them on Craigslist, you know, maybe somebody's, you know, growing them in a bin, then you could take those from the bin and say you get 1 pound, you could put a handful of this bed, a handful of that bed, and put them in a couple different places, you know, and then they could just basically hopefully live in your beds if you provide them a good home. And this is the method I prefer. I've relocated worms in my raised beds many times, and some of my raised beds now basically has nice populations of worms, and sometimes I lose some, so then I actually have to try to replace them and figure out, hey, what am I doing wrong? And generally for me, it means I'm either overwatering or underwatering. And I think in most cases, I tend to underwater a little bit for my worms because they will dry out if they're not being well kept. And that's actually one of the benefits of having them in a worm bin, is that you can better monitor the conditions than maybe just in soil. So yeah, keeping worms in the soil is the best place. And then basically when you top off your raised beds at the end of every season with a good rich mixture of compost, rock dust, soil humates, and different things, biochar, then basically you're not only feeding your soil, you're not only feeding your plants, but guess what? You're feeding the worms. And when the worms eat some of these specialized foods, basically it's gonna supercharge their castings. Now, if you guys do wanna learn about worms, I would recommend this book. This is actually the 35th anniversary, over 200,000 copies sold. This is probably the number one book on worms. It's basically says, Worms Eat My Garbage. I mean, that is literally the title of the book. And it's by Mary Applehoff and Joanne Olszowski. And this will tell you how to make a very simple worm bin out of lumber. And, you know, I don't necessarily recommend this bin because it's like a non-flow-through. So if you did want to build something, I would recommend building like a flow-through style. Like one of the ones that I'm going to share with you guys today. You could surely make a flow-through style that's also like the bin like this with some grate at the bottom. But yeah, this will give you guys all the information you guys need about worms. All right, so now I want to share with you guys actually a worm feeding station that I would prefer you guys make even over one of the bins that I'm going to show you guys. And once again, there's pros and cons to each method. I like this method because it's more natural. You don't have to really keep worms out of their environment that they should live in, which is the soil, and be connected to the earth, the ground, and in a plastic bin. And so what I want you guys to do is make a worm feeding station. I'll have an upcoming episode if you guys want. Thumbs up this video and post a comment. Let me know that, hey, John, I want to see your feeding station video. And I'll get off my tushy and I'll make a video showing you guys how to do it. Super simple. All you need really is a 5-gallon bucket with a lid. Very important. You guys do need the lid for the bucket. We don't have the lid today. What you're going to do with the bucket is, number one, you're going to take basically like a maybe half-inch drill, and 4 inches down from the top, you're going to basically just make this Swiss cheese. You're going to drill holes in random places. Doesn't really matter where. You're just going to fill this bottom all with holes. That's step one. Step two is then you're going to cut off the bottom. So take a jigsaw, hacksaw, whatever you guys got. Cut off the bottom of the bucket so that when you look through it, you could see through the other side. So now you have basically a tube and it has all holes in there. Then what you're gonna do is you're gonna go ahead and dig a hole. You're gonna bury this bucket. Whether you wanna bury it in one of your raised beds to have the feeding station in your raised beds, which I personally wouldn't do. I would put it in another area of my garden, maybe off in the corner or something like that, under some shrubs, underneath a tree. And then basically you're gonna dig a hole so that this whole bucket could fit underneath the soil. And all you're going to see is literally just enough of the ring on the top here to just be at the same level of the soil. So if we buried it in here, we basically just see the bucket. It would be basically soil from like here down all around. And then what you're going to do is then you're going to take your food scraps and you're going to basically put them in the bottom of the bucket, which is actually now open. It has all the holes on the sides. And then you may introduce some worms into there, so they're going to have basically a nice place to live. You're going to go ahead and maybe put on some shredded newspaper, I like to use the shredded craft paper from paper grocery bags, or you could use some coconut coir as their bedding material. Mix that up, put the lid on top, and if you put worms in there, they're going to already go to work, start eating that. They're going to be under the ground. They're going to have a nice temperature-controlled environment so that you don't have to control the temperature like you guys will learn that they are doing here. And if you don't put worms in here, guess what? Worms could smell, or they know where there's food, and they're gonna find their way, and they're gonna find the way to the food, so that they're just gonna gather in here, and you're just gonna provide them literally like a nice home to live in. And you're just gonna keep this covered all the time, maybe put a rock on the top, maybe even cover it up with something else, so it doesn't get too hot down in there for them. And that's the best way to keep worms, in my opinion. Now, if you don't want to use this kind of bucket method and have a feeding station in your soil, in the ground, like I believe you guys should, they have some bins that can make it more convenient. Say you live in an apartment or a condo and you don't have space to put a feeding station in, do this. Now, in the feeding station, of course, you can you know, harvest when you need to, that, but harvesting is a little bit messy because you're going to maybe slow down on the feeding and you're just going to go to the bottom of the bin and basically take all the castings out. You're going to have to sort out worms. What I would do in that case is I would harvest the castings and then basically put them in with the worms and castings. If you do grab any, just bury them in your garden beds and just various places, right? But keep using this as your feeding station. Anyways, for those of you guys that aren't able to have a feeding station, you know, keeping worms is definitely excellent because you can control them, you can keep in a confined space, and you could literally do them anywhere. So let's go ahead and learn about the two different bins they are using here at Ann Wigmore Insitute, and actually, which one is better so you guys can save yourself some time, money, and headaches. All right, so now I want to show you guys actually the two worm bins they're using here at the Ann Wigmore Insitute, and how one of these guys actually is not really good, and you shouldn't buy it, basically, is what I'm telling you. and as well as the other one that actually is really good. So this guy is actually called the Urban Worm Bag by the Urban Worm Company. And in my opinion, the Urban Worm Bag Company should be ashamed of themselves because they are selling POSs like this. So what happened was they got shipped in here, and this comes with like some kind of like a thin wall metal framing with these like plastic connectors. And the problem is the metal framing might be good, but it seems kind of chintzy to me. But these plastic connectors are not good. And the problem is when this bag is fully full with the worm castings and the food scraps, it gets really heavy. So let's see. Man, I can barely lift this up myself. Ow. So what happened was this original black framing that you guys see just on the top broke. And then they were struggling to figure how can we keep this up because the framing broke. And you know, here in Puerto Rico, they got to get everything shipped in, hard to get parts, all this kind of stuff. So, you know, they basically had to make their own frame out of basically steel tubing here, and that's what this gray system is. Basically, they had to make their own frame because the frame that came with this one basically busted out. And, you know, that it shouldn't be like that, right? And so then the other thing is that this guy is also, you know, it's about one-third the cost of the one you guys are going to see in a minute, but, you know, you guys get what you pay for. So this is called a flow-through system, unlike a standard using a standard bin that you'll have to harvest the worm castings out of. The goal on these systems is actually you feed on the top, and as the worms eat the garbage or the food scraps, right, the castings fall to the bottom, and you keep feeding on top, so the worms go to the top. So literally you could just take the zipper down here on the bottom and unzip it and get the castings that are finished out the bottom. And then you keep feeding on the top. Now, this is all done with zippers. They look to be pretty heavy duty zippers, but Kailash, who we will interview at the end of this episode, has been using this system, and the zipper on the top works pretty good, and he'll basically feed the food scraps here. And in this bin, he actually has the African night crawlers because we're just actually in an area of the greenhouse that is not climate controlled. It's just basically in the shade. So this could get maybe like 80 degrees or so. And you know, it looks like they are basically digesting everything he's putting in there pretty good. And the African night crawlers need more warmer temperatures. So if you live in a temperate climate where it's not, you know, constantly warm, the African night crawlers may die, so you will not want to get those. And then the problem with the zipper thing is on the bottom, when he tries to unzip the bottom, he could never really seem to zip it or you know, just enough so that you just get, you portion control the castings as they're coming out. They just dump out either all too fast or just too slow. In addition, you guys can see this bag, which is, you know, heavy duty. It is also getting stained and hard to keep clean. You know, they try to have a nice sterile environment here, but this bag is getting stained and hard to keep clean. And the zipper on the top is working pretty good. But the problem, and that's a good reason for that, is because basically this is not sitting in dirt or soil, but the zipper on the bottom is basically getting all the dirt and the castings all down below, as well as the liquid. So it's a little bit wet down here, and you know, the stuff could get in the zipper, so then it may fail over time. So yeah, they had so the issues with this bag, staining, not super durable, it has broke. The bag is staining, you can't harvest the castings easily, and the other thing is the leachate or the worm elixir basically doesn't leak out because you know, this bag just gets soaked, and maybe some of it might drip out or might just evaporate because this bag is moist. So this is not the ideal design, although it does work, right? But you know, I always want you guys, if you guys are buying something, you know, buy something good so you have to buy it once instead of having to buy, you know, something that breaks and then having to keep rebuying it or having to make your own fix like the handy welders here. in Puerto Rico did for this urban worm bag. So let's go ahead and take a look at the worm bin you guys should get if you guys are considering purchasing a worm bin. All right, so this is the Hungry Bin, and actually this is the bin that they had a lot better luck with and success. And when I open this guy, I don't know if I could do that for you guys. Let's see here. I open this guy, you guys can't really see in too much, but this is flourishing. There's like so many worms in there. They're just eating everything. It's just amazing how many worms, and they're light sensitive, right? So I mean, today it's daylight, so you don't want to like keep this open too long. Not too good for the little babies. And also when you close the bin, make sure there's no worms stuck in the hinges or the clothing pads, because you don't want to crush any of them. Anyways, this bin is literally modeled after one of those push totes that they use for garbage. And actually I met the inventor of this machine, of this unit, and visited his factory, or his warehouse in New Zealand when I was there on a trip. So if you haven't seen that episode, want to learn all you need to know about the Hungry Bin, check the link down below in the description. I'll have a video where I actually visited the warehouse and interviewed the owner and saw his different models that he basically made on his own until he made this one and designed it out of plastic, and it breaks down to be shipped easily. So unlike the other one that basically the framing broke, this one actually has nice, sturdy, galvanized metal framing that's nice and solid here. In addition, it has wheels. This is something also Kailash likes, because he can move this in and out where he needs to. The other one is not on wheels, and that's definitely a problem for him. In addition, this has a tray on the bottom to catch the leachate or the tea worm elixir, whatever you guys want to call it. And there's these little snap hooks that easily allow you to take off this little cover here, that then you can easily harvest some of the worm castings. They won't fall out too fast or too slow, because they basically, this comes down to like a nice funnel, and it's properly designed. In addition, this is a lot more heavy duty. It's easier to clean, and there's no zippers to break, get stuck, or anything. Now I think this is maybe like three times the price of that other guy, but buy something once and do it right. So yeah, this is the Hungry Bin. Oh yeah, and in here I'm in a climate controlled area of the greenhouse now. It basically stays around 70 degrees in here, 70-75. So if you guys do keep worms, and oh, so the other one was an African nightcrawlers, and that other bin, this is the red wigglers. The red wigglers like it cool, so if you can keep your red wigglers around 70 degrees, 75, that'd be optimal, right? And think about it, if they are in the ground, even if your weather is 80 degrees, if they're in the ground, then more than likely, the ground is cooler than the outside air. But the problem is when you're keeping them in a bin, especially if it's outside, this bin is gonna get hot because it's not insulated with the ground. So you really have to pay attention to the temperature of your worm bin. Like I went to a guy in Phoenix and he keeps his worms underneath the tree. And in the summertime, he actually takes blocks of ice and puts blocks of ice on top of the worms to basically let the ice melt to keep his worms cool. I don't know that I'd go that far. I'd probably just have a worm bin inside my house under air conditioning if I really want to keep them that bad. But once again, if you put them in the soil, and if it's too hot up top, guess what? They're gonna go a little bit deeper so that they can keep themselves cool, so that you don't have to work to keep them cool, right? I'm all about trying to model nature and make keeping worms easy for us, and that's why I like the worm feeding stations that are in the ground. The worms can freely come and go if they're hungry. They could go somewhere else. They could burrow deeper if they need to. If it's too hot, it's a lot easier than keeping a bin. But yeah, I know for some of you guys, bins can be really nice. Also, this will allow you to really ramp up your casting production if you're trying to do that. Big worm farms that I go to, they don't have feeding stations. They just have actually bins, which is the big produce crates that they use. I think so. They have the red wigglers in here. They've done amazing in this temperature range. Keep them in the right temperature and feed them appropriately. If you create food waste every day, don't always feed them every day, right? But one of the things Kailash does is he'll freeze the food scraps if he has too much to feed them, and then he'll freeze it and save it up. And then once, they eat their food, he'll basically thaw out the food scraps, which then helps the decomposition process. He'll thaw them out, let them heat up a little bit, and then put them in here so that the worms could literally eat the thawed food, that the freezing process breaks some of the cell walls open, that helps the degradation of the foods, so that the worms could basically digest and eat the scraps faster. I think that's pretty much all I have to say about the Hungry Bin. It ships easy, nice and sturdy, it's on wheels. You can harvest the casting, you can harvest the, let's talk about the worm tea here. The the worm leachate there or the worm elixir, you should mix that down. Maybe like literally 2 ounces per 1 gallon is a good mixture. And then, you know, spray it on your plants. The other thing is the leachate or the worm elixir should not smell like nasty. If it's smelling nasty, you got some problems in your bin. It's not working properly. You're probably overfeeding. And make sure, you know, to keep a nice humidity level in for your worms. They don't like it too dry, but they don't like it too wet either. So, you know, if it's too dry, you can add some liquid food scraps, like, you know, juice pulp, fruits and vegetable scraps. Fruits generally tend to be more higher water content than vegetables. And now if it's too wet, then you want to add in like coconut coir that's dry coconut coir shreds, or you could add in like shredded newspaper, all right? So yeah, this is the bin I'd recommend if you guys need to get a bin. But what I'd like to do next, actually, we're gonna go ahead and get Kailash, the instructor that teaches all the gardening courses and the sprouting and the composting here at the Ann Wigmore Institute, to show the guys his personal experiences with these worm bins. So now the special opportunity to interview for you guys, Kailash Niels, one of the instructors here at the Ann Wigmore Institute. He happens to teach actually all the greenhouse classes, including growing and sprouting, the worm composting, as well as the standard composting. He teaches the yoga, which I took this morning, as well as many other classes here at Ann Wigmore. So Kailash, thanks for taking time out of your day to share some of your experience with my viewers today. And Kailash has been growing food for over 25 years now. He doesn't even look a day over 25. Look at this guy. It must be the Ann Wigmore, all these sprouts. These are biogenic food that you guys can grow inside your living room. You need to eat more of these guys. The sprouts, number one food to keep young, in my opinion. We're not here to talk about sprouts today. We are here to talk about the worms. You guys just saw the worm bins, some of the various ways you can keep worms. So, Kailash, why does the Ann Wigmore Institute here keep the worms and teach the attendees about composting with worms?
Well, I want to start with this. Before I came here, when Ann Wigmore was still alive, she brought worms down here to Puerto Rico, and she wanted to do worm composting. However, in this heat, the types of worms that she brought, they didn't survive. And so now, decades later, I kind of got into the whole worm composting thing, and I decided to get the Californian red wigglers, because here we have this air-conditioned environment now, and I figured they would be doing really good in this environment. So when I got them, I didn't know about tropical worms, which I got too. I'll talk about that in a moment. And it turns out that these red wigglers are doing really good in this air-conditioned environment, where we're growing some of the microgreens like the wheatgrass and others. And so they don't like hot temperatures, so they wouldn't actually be surviving in this kind of environment here, where it goes up into the 90s and it's very humid. So at one point the AC was down, and actually I lost a lot of my worms. So it really, I saw that they would not survive in the heat. However, in this area here, in this air-conditioned area, the temperature's always around 70, you know, it's set to 64, but actually it's always a little warmer than that, and they do really, really good in this type of environment, in this temperature here.
Cool, yeah, and I do want to comment that, you know, I was just at a worm farm just a few episodes ago, and they have the same red wigglers that they ordered online, got shipped to Puerto Rico, and they're growing them in a non-air-conditioned environment, in a basement. And literally just, you know, it's in shade for sure, not direct sun, in bins that are covered, and they water them down actually to keep them a little bit more happy. Now, I will say that your worms inside this bin look way more amazing than the guy's worm that I saw, but he was affected by the hurricane, had a food shortage and a water shortage, so he lost a lot of his worms. But nonetheless, you guys went through the same hurricane here, and this bin is like the most amazing, like, hungry bin I've ever seen of all my travels. And I went to the owner's house in New Zealand, and I don't think it was as good as this.
Wow.
So why does Ann Wigmore keep the worms in the first place?
Well, one of the ideas is to get the richest soil possible in terms of nutrients. And studies have shown that worm compost has 10 times more nutrients than regular backyard compost.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, I would definitely... say that's totally true, and you guys need to start a worm composting, whether you want to do in a bin or just in your raised beds like I like to do. I also add the worm castings into my garden. As you guys see, I'll put a link down below to a video where I doubled my harvest actually by adding a special worm castings to my peppers. And I did testing between two different worm casting companies, and one did significantly better than the other. The other thing I will say is that if you make worm castings, yes, worm castings almost in all situations are better than just a standard backyard compost, but worm castings can be made better by actually adding additional feeding nutrients to the worms. So check the link down below once again to a video I made visiting a worm farm in California where they actually add specific ingredients to their feed to basically supercharge the castings that are coming out. So yes, great Ann Wigmore here is being more sustainable on the planet by basically using all the food scraps that are being generated on site to do composting as well as worm composting. In addition, you know, they collect rainwater, you guys have a solar system, so should something happen, you guys are prepared, because not only do you have the seeds saved up, but you guys are literally growing your own fertilizer in here. So Kailash, what has been your experiences with the two bins? I mean, I shared some of this earlier with my viewers, but I want it from the horse's mouth because you set up both these systems, you take care of them on a regular basis. What are your comments?
So I started with this, the Hungry Bin, which you actually recommended, and I wanted to make sure I get the best, start with the best, and I've been super happy with this. I have no complaints whatsoever. This system has been working really perfectly. And what I didn't know when I bought this, that there's also tropical worms. And so later on, I wanted to get another system to check it out, which, and what I got is the urban worm bag. And I bought African night crawlers that like humid environment. They like the humidity, they like the heat. And so I, just to see how people who actually live in the tropics that come here from Puerto Rico or from other islands or other parts in the world, I wanted to also show them that they could do it in the tropics. And so I got the urban worm bag, I got the African night crawlers, and it's pretty amazing how much they eat. Although I don't see them very much, it seems like they go down, but they eat awesome, large, they go through large quantities of compost. And so what I like about this much better is that it has a hole, actually a screen and a hole on the bottom, and all the liquid can drain right through into a tray, the tray that's on the bottom, and we use that, whereas the bag doesn't have that. Plus here, there's the tray on the bottom, it's so easy to remove the tray and to just take out the castings and then to mix it with our soil or use it straight and plant things. Whereas the bag, there's the zipper, and it sometimes it's a little bit difficult, sometimes too much seems to be falling through harvesting the soil from the worm bag. Plus the frame is not strong enough to hold the weight of the bag, and actually broke down after a short period of time, and we had to build a new frame, and it's the connectors and the pieces in general, they're just not as strong. Well, there's a big price difference, but I think it's really worth getting the Hungry Bin because it'll virtually last forever, whereas the bag, after a while you have to replace it, and the frame already broke down after a short period of time.
Wow, so how much do your worms eat, like the night crawlers versus the red wigglers? Now I know you have dispargy because you have a lot more red wigglers than the night crawlers from just opening the bin and seeing how many are in there.
Yeah, I'm not sure really. They both eat large amounts. Whatever I put, you know, they eat, they go through, so I haven't measured it by weight. And I just see the Californian, the red wigglers much more, and it seems as though they eat more. But then when I go to the worm bag and in the morning, like they have also, although I don't see the worms very much, they go through whatever I put in there. So I haven't measured it yet.
Right, and so what? How often do you feed the worms, and what are you feeding them specifically?
So I feed them every few days, depending on how much. Sometimes I give them something every day, but I'd say on average every 3 days. And what I give them are primarily soft things, like banana peels or bananas that were overripe, or avocado pieces that weren't good to eat, or a fiber from juice, things like that, things that are relatively soft. So I learned the hard way at the beginning. I put the top part of the bananas, you know, where they connect, and that is too much fiber, and it kind of it clogged the bottom of the bin, and I had to take everything out just to, because it decomposted at a much slower rate than everything else, and also seed like shells, some of those things like the sunflower, the shells, they decompost a lot slower than just peels or leftover food. So it's important not to put things that take a long time to decompose, like, you know, date pits or mango pits, those kind of things. We put in the hot compost because the hot compost will break it down, may take a few cycles, but eventually that will break it down. So soft things are, they do best with softer things.
Great, and the other thing I'd recommend you guys, if you guys get any kind of bin, you know, don't constantly, oh, I got extra food scraps today, don't just keep piling it in. It's like you're going to feed them too fast and that food's going to end up rotting, so you always want to just get it. If, like, you see that they're almost low on food, add some more, and then, you know, cover it up, and then don't add more until you uncover what you put in there, and if it's gone, then yes, add some more, right? But don't just keep piling stuff in as fast as you make it, because sometimes your worms can't keep up until there's a sufficient quantity of worms in there. I heard that the worms could eat, like, their weight in food a day, I believe, is, like, from my memory. Another thing I like about the hungry bin environment is that you literally are creating a home for worms. And so, Kailash, do you want to talk about how you referred to these almost as like pets, right?
Yeah, I love to come out here, and it's just a peaceful place for me. And I open the bin and I look at them, and when I take them off the lid, sometimes they're on the lid, and I make sure they don't get injured. So, I mean, I've really come to like to working with the worms, and it's just amazing to me through how much food they go. And also, I've realized that the more I feed them, the faster they reproduce, and then if I give them less food, they just don't reproduce as much, you know. So if I'm gone for 2 weeks, I'll just add a lot of food, but I notice the population will have gone down a little bit. And then once I start feeding them again, I'll see all these little white and then later reddish worms, and it's pretty amazing. It's like, it's a miracle.
Wow, that's a ticket. So I guess maybe if you're kind of high and dry with your wife, your husband, boyfriend, feed them more food. Maybe you'll get more lucky more often. All right, Kailash, so are there any other final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share with my viewers today about the two worm bins that you've been keeping, or any tips you've learned about keeping worms here at the Ann Wigmore Institute?
Well, as I mentioned, this bin is really, I've seen a few different systems, and this system works the best, at least from everything that I've seen in my own personal experience. If you get the right worms, they will always go to the surface, they will all be always be on top, and then you harvest on the bottom. So what you take out, the bottom tray, really should not have any worms in it, so it's not the type of system where you have to pick through the soil and take out all the worms and separate them. Having the right worms, they will go to the surface, so make sure you get the ones that are the right ones for your kind of environment, or whether indoors or outdoors. This is usually kept indoors, and actually a lot of people I've seen, they have this in their living room, and it's not a problem really.
Where have you seen somebody have it in their living room?
I've seen people in New York having that.
This whole thing in the living room, wow.
Yes, and it doesn't smell. It's not messy at all. You know, you just keep adding the food scraps, you cover them a little bit, and unless you go deep, if you dig deeper, there's a little bit of a smell. But in general, if we were to open this right now, there's no smell. And also the tea that comes out in the bottom, there's no smell to it. And as long as you feed them enough, then they won't try to crawl out. It's only when you don't give them enough food, or if it's too moist inside, because they breathe through their skin, then they try to look for either food or a drier place.
So how do you compensate for if you have too much wet stuff? What do you put in there to make it a little bit more dry for them?
So what I do is I add shredded paper, or from the toilet paper, the roll, and break it, or just put the whole thing to assimilate some of the extra moisture.
Yeah, I would recommend, you know, basically shredding up, like I shred up like brown paper bags in a micro shredder, and get micro shreds, and it would add that in there. The other thing I might add is like some coconut coir fiber. You know, that's really good to add also. You know, just get a coconut coir block and expand it, and then dry it, and then add it in there to help soak up some of the moisture. All right, Kailash, so this has been very helpful, hopefully for you guys out there. Now, Kailash, you want to say any words of wisdom or share anything about the Ann Wigmore Institute, because some of my viewers may not know about the great work that the Ann Wigmore Institute has been doing here in Puerto Rico like since 1990.
Yes, so it's just amazing to me. First institute started in 1963, and the institute is going stronger than ever. The word is out, people know about this lifestyle, and what I personally love about it, it's really about reconnecting with nature and growing your own food indoors, you know, growing your own sprouts, growing your own microgreens, and even composting in a small apartment. I thought in that sense that Wigmore was a genius, really thinking about how we can be more sustainable even if we don't have a backyard, even if we live in a small apartment where we can grow at least some sprouts and some of our microgreens, and even if we have enough space for a bin like this, compost and then use that soil to grow our microgreens in.
Amazing, amazing. Yeah, so how can somebody learn more about the Ann Wigmore Natural Health Institute here in Puerto Rico?
The website is a great place to go to, annwigmore.org, and there's also a short video on the website, and there's several videos on YouTube, and I know you've done a few.
I've done a few.
Yes, so that'd be a great place to learn more about the Ann Wigmore Institute.
All right, awesome. Yeah, if you guys want to learn more about the Institute, check the link down below. Hopefully I will have posted the video I made this trip about the Ann Wigmore Institute and everything that you guys learn here. I mean, you will learn how to do the worm composting, probably from Kailash if he's not traveling. You'll learn how to do the standard composting. You'll learn how to grow wheatgrass, the sunflower greens, all this kind of stuff that you guys could do wherever you live. And besides that, you're coming here to paradise. You're going to get all the food made for you. You're just going to take classes and eat and hang out and meet new friends and just have a great time and probably lose weight and get healthier at the same time, all right?
And go to the beach.
And go to the beach right down the way. Yeah, I mean, the beach is right outside your office, which is really nice. So in any case, if you guys enjoyed this episode learning about the worm composting bins here at the Ann Wigmore Institute, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. I'll be sure to come back next time I'm at Ann Wigmore and make more videos with Kailash. This guy is a wealth of knowledge. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes. I've come out every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up, where we'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And make sure you click the little bell so you get notified. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. I will put links to two of the videos I've made here on previous trips to Ann Wigmore, how they grow indoors and outdoors and all this kind of stuff. So check those links as well as all my other videos that are a wealth of knowledge that will empower you so you guys can grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.